Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello. So I will take your questions. I can see your questions here, and I can take them one by one. So I hope you're enjoying the course, and I'm happy to see your questions. So I'll take the first question here. My question is: So you want to learn foreign languages? Phonetics would help us acquire pronunciation. And as I study languages, I wonder if we have a central website where we have IPA marked in the phonetics chart with their alphabets, not IPA, but actual native script letters. Knowledge of this makes easier language acquisition rather than the need to understand linguistics in regular phonetic languages. Converted to IPA, thus sensitizing the change in pronunciation, which the dictionary restricts to the word alone. So there are a couple of questions here, Mr. Raj Kurvila. So I would take them one by one. So I understand you are interested in foreign languages a lot. And in that case, it would be extremely helpful for you if you learn the international phonetic alphabets sounds which are associated with the symbols. Because the reason why is that helps you to understand the sounds in greater detail. Because, you know, whether you're learning German or whether you're learning French, each of these languages have unique sounds. Okay? So, and those, and the unique sounds can be understood better if you follow the international phonetic alphabet's representation of those sounds. And, In a way, that is also helping you to understand all other languages. So the IPA chart is there not just for one language, it's there for all other languages. So since you're interested in multiple languages, it also helps you to see how sounds vary from their idealized sounds. Okay. And hence, I would very much recommend you to learn the IPA chart. So your question then is, phonetics would help us acquire pronunciation, and that's very true. And you wonder this central website. So, see, there are 6 to 7 thousand languages in the world. So it's not possible to have the IPA marked for each and every, I mean, for many of those languages, we have not even done the documentation of the languages properly. Hence, it is a task which is, you know, left to linguists to do. And it's a big task. It's not an easy task. So, hence there is, for individual languages, if you go to, Wikipedia, for instance, is extremely helpful. I have seen that Wikipedia has updated, updates itself. The people who make the entries, of course, update, the resources of individual languages with the, international phonetic alphabets charts and the language repositories of individual languages. Those things are done there, but there's no central repository for all the languages of the world. So that would be an extremely difficult task and has not been done. But that would be an extremely as a helpful thing to do for people who want to learn languages. So I hope I have answered the first two parts, and the third part of your question is about yes, it makes language acquisition easier, definitely, rather than need to understand linguistics in regular phonetic language. So something I would like to stress is that learning the phonetics you know, is if you're interested in learning languages, it's quite basic, because I'll say something here. I think that it's a drawback in the education systems of most of the languages of the world, that the phonetics part is not incorporated. It should be incorporated very early in the language curriculum, so that people who are learning their own languages also know their sounds. So we as linguists would always try to advocate for the inclusion of at least that part, because that's not really very specialized knowledge. That's knowledge about the language that you speak. So I would say that's very essential. And then you are saying converted to International Phonetic Association symbols, thus sensitizing the change in pronunciation which the dictionary restricts to the word alone. And some dictionaries actually include the IPA pronunciation. So there's this, for English we have a proper pronunciation dictionary. So Cambridge publishes it and updates it regularly. So English is that way very, very privileged. Not all languages have that. And it will be, unless there are very good people who know how to transcribe the language very well, unless that is there, it would be difficult to have those dictionaries, but it will be extremely helpful for people who learn languages, even young learners of their own languages. It will be useful. So I hope I have answered the questions. So I think there is a follow-up saying, especially in non-phonetic languages, where in case adjacent requires required pronunciation change. Very true. There is a lot of change in pronunciation as one goes along in a word. And for instance, in French, you have liaison, etc. So those things are almost essential. And it's part of, so I would say that this is not very specialized knowledge. This is part of learning the language, learning the phonetics, learning the phonological rules is almost as essential as learning the grammar of the language. Or because if you are learning a language, you need to know a couple of grammatical rules. So for instance, English, if we don't know the agreement rule, the third person, the subject, agrees with the verb, or even in the case of plurals, etc. So if we don't know these basic rules, we make grammatical mistakes. Similarly, with regard to phonological rules also, where there's change in pronunciation because of sandhi rules, etc. Those are essential and should be a place where all these things are there. But unfortunately, especially in India, teaching languages is extremely poor. Our own languages, we learn them in extremely impoverished conditions. So the way they're taught to us, even in advanced schools, is very poor. So hence, we should try to have these things. And I would encourage everyone who's doing this course to be more and more interested in phonetics and phonology, so that it also helps developing our own languages. So I think
you should try to have these things, and I would encourage everyone who's doing this course to be more and more interested in phonetics and phonology, so that it also helps developing our own languages.
I think there are other questions as to whether IPA marked in the phonetic chart with their alphabets in original script. So I understand there is this issue of script, which I tried to in my lecture I tried to create this sort of the issue that the script does not always reflect the pronunciation. So, but I understand to know the language properly, you need to know the script. But to an extent, they are related, but we have to understand that to an extent they're also not related. So because there can be very often sort of a disjunction between what is there in the script and how it's pronounced. So keeping in mind that one would have to learn the phonetics of the language and the script and see the relations themselves. So it would not be always, unless there are dictionaries of that language where the script is also there and the associated marks, the transcriptions are also there. Unless that is there, it would not be possible for a linguist, for instance, to do that. So if that's the question, then that's how I'd like to answer it, that one will have to learn the script for the purpose of learning the language properly, but one will also have to learn the phonetics of the language. And for that, it will be easier if we know the phonetic transcription, the symbols, associated symbols with different sounds in the language. And so, for instance, the R will be written as R in both French and German and Dutch and English, but their pronunciation for these different languages will be different. So it is not pronounced as R in French or in German. So there are differences, and that's the part where we have to be aware of the importance of the phonetic transcription. So I think we have questions related to how to prepare for the exams. We are being not asking answers which require long answers. So most of the questions are MCQ type questions and questions which require just ticking a box and things like that. There will be some questions, problem solving type questions, where also you will have to select one of the answers. So it's just enough to know the way as to what are the concepts that are being taught here. So I think that's understanding those concepts and understanding how, for instance, a phonology problem is solved, how to find the minimal pair, how to find that two sounds are contrastive. So once that much is clear, I think answering the phonology part will be very clear, for instance, very easy. And then also there are for the other parts, which we have already put the questions there. So I think many of you have taken the questions or seen the question papers. Then there you have to, they're mostly MCQ questions, type questions, and just the concepts which are there, and you have to select the right answer. And sometimes they are true or false type questions also. There's a question like, is there a central repository for all languages? Any repository for major languages besides Wikipedia? So any repository for major languages? Major languages, no. So because that's a good question, because you have to understand that language is not seen as language comes with a whole range of identity issues, cultural issues. So any particular country or website domain will not have the rights to be the central repository for different languages. So that is the issue there. So for instance, why will French Canadian allow some country in Europe to host their the resources for their language, right? So So as I said, language comes with a host of other issues related to nationality, to identity, etc. And that's why I do not have central repository for all languages, because a language is, you know, of course, we all love languages. We want to know more about languages, but language is related to other questions like culture and identity. How to improve pronouncing words. So practice, I think. Practice, follow the the language you're trying to improve. Listen to a lot of it and try to see what are the so one way is that you can also record your own speech and compare it to how you have spoken and how it would be, I don't know what your target language is. Suppose it's English, but then English doesn't have one standard variety. English has many standard varieties. So there's British English, there's American English. So you can compare, you can record your own speech and compare it with, a similar rendition of American English or British English and see what are the ways that you can improve yours better. And you will find resources on the internet about all these things as to, but then it you have to know which variety you want to work on. So a difference between phonetics and phonology. I have discussed this in my lectures, but I will say this again. Phonetics is the physical properties of speech. Phonology is about the mental organization of the same properties. So basically, phonology deals with the abstract properties of speech, and phonology, for instance, when we're doing phonology, we are what we talk about as a surface representation will be close to what is actually spoken. But then for everything, we have to understand there is also a mental representation. So my part of the phonology talk where I talk about the psychological reality of phonemes is pretty much about that. So this, why? So the underlying, the sounds which are there in our mental representation is actually what we store in our cognitive systems. So basically, the sounds that we actually produce are not the sounds which we think we are pronouncing. So most of the time, that's what happens when we play a sound back. We think that, this is not. Sometimes this happens that you do not even hear a part of the sound that you actually thought you pronounced. So when you look at the acoustic signal, that might also happen because that is all because the way we mentally store the sounds is different from the way we actually pronounce them. So, and very often there is deletion, there is insertion, there are all kinds of processes happening. And that's because of the way we store the grammar of sounds and its actual pronunciation. So there are two levels, for instance. And of course, the two come together. We cannot say that these are completely, there's complete disjunction between phonetics and phonology. That's not the case. But it's also not the case that everything is always seen on the surface. Even if we look at the acoustic signal, we might find differences from what the representation of the sound is in our mental maps. So why don't we speak English in correct accent like a foreigner? Is it phonetics or is it phonetics we are to work on, or is it prosody? Can I have more information of prosody or the suprasegmental part in the IPA chart? Why don't we speak English in correct? So let's, for instance, to start with, let's make a distinction between correct and what we are targeted accent. So there's nothing like correct or wrong when we are speaking, especially when we are speaking another language, because we are not. That was not our ambient language when we where we were born or where we grew up. So obviously, we will not speak like a person who was born and brought up in that environment. So we did not acquire that let's say for what you're saying, accent. So accent can mean various things. So we have discussed a bit in the lectures. But I will go to the next part. Is it phonetics we are to work on, or is it prosody? Prosody includes both phonetics and phonology. So if we want to improve our pronunciation, or if we want to, I don't know what exactly improve will imply. So I assume it means, or improve or correct, or all these things imply that we have certain target to reach. So we have, suppose we want to speak like an American speaker, even there. So which American accent? So there are various American accents. So, and even when you're talking about British accents, so there are many accents that they're there. So we have a target and we have to reach that target. So let's talk about that. So if that's our aim, then what are we supposed to do? Then we have to work on. So phonetics does not exclude prosody. So both. So if we want to achieve a certain target, then we have to understand how the different sounds are being produced, or what is. So we can work on the differences. So how am I pronouncing this, and how is this targeted accent is like. So we can always make a comparison between that. And the phonetics, as I said, does not exclude prosody. So prosody has both a phonetic and a phonological component, which we'll come to in the last part of this course. So, which is tone and intonation, where we'll talk about prosody and tone and intonation. And the prosody will tell you as to where to put the stress in a sentence, in a word, when you're trying to pronounce, when you're asking a question, where do you have to have the rise, the type of question you want to ask, WH question, yes, no question, where do you have to put the stress in a sentence, in a word. So all those things will be what is the so-called supra-segmental properties will be a part of prosody. So, of course, all the segmental parts will be what we traditionally know as phonetics. And so that will be all the vowels and consonants. But regardless of whether we want to improve our pronunciation or not, we would always, if we want to learn different languages, we always benefit from knowing what those properties are. So I hope that is a proper answer to that question. And so another question here is, can we have the answers of the weekly assignment by the end of the course? Sure. So all the answers are already given, and they will be posted after the by the end of the course. Yes. So I think we have already taken this question. What's the best way to learn English phonetics? What's the best way to learn English phonetics? Okay, so I would suggest that we have to first learn, we have to first understand what the sounds of that language is. So suppose British English. So British English is quite different from the way we speak English, like Indian English. So it has different sounds. For instance, in Indian English, we would never pronounce like th or the. So those are sounds produced by the native speakers. So, and again, for instance, the vowels. So English has many vowels. So at least 12 vowels and 8 diphthongs. So, and we have to know the vowels precisely to know where to produce which vowel. So, for instance, the schwa is a very important vowel in English. So stress is very important in English. And that is something that very often is difficult for speakers who are non-native speakers to acquire stress at a later, to acquire the properties of stress at a much later age, because some of the stress-related properties are idiosyncratic for different language, or for English. In English has stress rules, and some stress rules, and some words are actually not part of the stress rules. So then it becomes doubly difficult to learn those rules. And I'm speaking from perspective of the fact that we are Indian English speakers, so we are very often not taught what is stress and what is stress and accent in English. English is a stress language. So every word has its unique stress position in the syllable, which is stressed. And that's why when we are speaking to perhaps native speakers of English, it sounds very different from the way we would normally speak it. So that is another thing that one has to be aware of while trying to learn English phonetics, that the stress in individual words it depends on certain rules, and some very often actually almost 80-90% of the English lexicon is undergoes stress rules, but some are outside of it. And those things are which, if we want to really master the language to the extent that it is to the extent that we want to accomplish it to a certain level of perfection, then we have to learn those rules. And those are things. We have to learn the consonants, the vowels, the stress rules, the intonation properties, etc., which will then help us to learn the language to a certain extent, which is comparable to native speakers' language. And having said all this, I think I have to say that we should not hold ourselves guilty of not being able to speak or to attain certain level of perfection. Firstly, in our school systems, we are not taught the language in such a way that we have to, that we know the stress rules or we know the pronunciation. We are taught the language, we are taught how to just read and understand the language. So we are able to learn it the way or speak it the way that is done by the rest of the people in the country. So that is, I think, fine. As long as we can be intelligible, that is great work done. Because as much as we understand that English is sort of this language which is the window to the world, we should also be aware that it is not easy to learn so many languages. We in our country we already learn quite a few languages. So I think there is a question as to why is a vowel. In vowel sound production, there is no blockages, but in R pronunciation, when I can read the Devanagari here. So I think, can I use this pen? So I think I want to write. Yeah. Okay, so I think the vowel you are talking about is this vowel. This is, in linguistics, this is called the schwa. Okay, so now your question is, I am not very good in Devanagari, but I'm just trying to write what you have written there. Why is a vowel? That is the, if I'm not wrong, that is the nasalization symbol there in vowel sound. There is no, in vowel sound production, there is no blockages, but in R pronunciation, when you, If it's a vowel, we do not close the lips. So one of the things about vowel production is that there is clear passage of air. So the air is not blocked, as you rightly say. And even in I think because of the nasalization, you feel, I think, this means that, this means nasalization. So the air is also released from the nasal cavity. So maybe that's why you feel that this is a different vowel. This is a nasalized vowel, if I have understood you correctly. So Hindi has nasalized set of vowels. And that is, if that's a question. So yes, this is a nasalized vowel. It's different from our, it's different from the oral vowels. This is a nasalized vowel. So the other question is it possible for is it possible for non-native speakers of English to master intonation? Okay. Okay. Is this stream?
Yes.
So, this is the vowel that you may be asking about. Sure. And
this is the vowel that
and I think you have written this vowel, which is a nasalized vowel. And so the nasalized vowels are different because nasalized vowels are different from oral vowels. So how are they different? They're different because nasalized vowels are different from oral vowels because there is release of air from the nasal cavity.
Oral vowels. So how are they different? They're different because nasalized vowels are different from oral vowels because there is release of air.
So, I have a question here. Is it possible for non-native speakers of English to master intonation? So, yeah, why not? So, I think there is no reason why we cannot. There's no reason why we cannot master anything. Obviously we can with practice. We can obviously learn the intonation patterns of English and master it to a great extent.
Yeah, why not? So I think
yes.
There's no reason why we cannot
So, something about Wikipedia, something. But then that was the. Why is it not the Shua? It is definitely the vowel. So, it is a nasalized . But there is no see the controversy here. If it's a vowel, there is no blockage. There's no occlusion in vowels. It's as simple as that. If your phonology says there's an occlusion, then it's a consonant. So it's as simple as that. There's no controversy about those things at all. So, is this a question?
Yes.
So, per and per are two separate phonemes in the Indo-Aryan languages. However, I've seen many researchers in Indo-Aryan transcribe per with a superscript, a symbol that represents an allophone. I have been answered that broad categorization allows it and that it is correct. What superscript is that? I don't understand. So, per, this is the symbol for aspiration. So, if it is just per, it's not per her. So, it's not a cluster of sounds. That is clear in the phonetics that this is not a cluster of sounds. If I think the question being asked here is that per two phonemes. But this is not the way this can be represented. So, excuse me, this is the symbol. So, this is the super, this is not a superscript, actually. This is the way aspiration is represented. So, aspiration is represented with the breathiness on top of the consonant. So, yeah, it looks like superscript, but it is a symbol. And broad, so, and per and so if it's per, there is aspiration. So these are separate phonemes. And so I transcribe. And it is not paha. It's not a cluster of that stop and the fricative. So that's the point. And I have been answered that broad categorization allows it, and it is correct. Yes. So if it is aspiration, it has to be represented like that in IPA. So is such transcription allowed, or does it misrepresent? No. So it does not misrepresent the traits. So I don't know whether this is the point here, but very often people have this doubt about phonemes versus allophones. So I have said this numerous times in my lectures also, that what is phoneme in one language may be allophonic in another language. So in English, allophonically, the stops have aspiration, but in Indo-Aryan languages, you have pa. And as a phoneme, so or th or or th, so those are phonemes, and those will be represented with the aspiration symbol there. So and not as pa and her or th and her. So that would mean cluster of sounds, which is not the case.
As a phoneme, so or th or in
Tone is also a suprasegmental aspect. Is it a part of phonology? Tone is very much a part of phonology. It is a property of, it makes lexical distinction between words. So it is not like stress, or it is not a property which is separate from the sound, like other sounds. It behaves very much like, even though it is the difference between two sounds in a tone with lexical tone can be made with the difference in tone, like whether it's high or low, and it can be ba or ma. So that is not considered to be something which is separate from the segment so much, because it leads to lexical difference between the two words. It can mean two different things. That's why it's not considered. It's very much an integral part of the phonology of the languages where tone is phonemic. So we have a question here. When we analyze a phonological structure of a word, is it more appropriate to analyze the word as per syllabification or approaching it as initial, medial, final? If we choose the second, why? When we analyze a phonological structure of a word, is it more appropriate to analyze the word as per syllabification? Or as approaching this initial, medial, final? Phonological structure of a word and initial, medial, and final. I think what you mean here is initial, medial, final segments, because there are a couple of things here. Because as you know, a word might have both consonants and vowels. So are you talking about the consonants or the vowels? And are you talking about the initial, if you're talking about just the initial segment? So there are languages where, and this has been studied a lot in linguistics, so where we have domain initial strengthening. So we have strengthening of the initial segment. So, or we have in such a way that there will be no weakening of the initial segment. So there will be no processes which will target the loss of the initial segment, because it's considered very vital to the word, to the arrangement of the lexicon of the language. So hence in those cases you might say the initial position. So it's sometimes an initial position, or if a word final position is also sometimes important, because word finally, there is devoicing in languages. So word finally, for instance, we have also discussed that in the phonology of languages, for instance, Slavic languages, for instance, even German has word final devoicing. So there we're not talking about syllable, there we're talking about the word, the position in the word, of the final position. So however, for very many other things, for instance, stress, for instance, even tone, we talk about the syllable, the initial syllable, because the stress falls on the vowel, the stress or the sonorant sometimes in some language. So, or whatever bears the nucleus of that syllable. So hence, you are talking about the syllables when you're talking about those phenomena. But in some cases, yes, we can talk about initial and final positions of a word. Many linguists are monolingual. Is it true? Is it oxymoronic? Can linguistic teachers mimic or fake accents? In spite of their knowledge, I do not find such, you don't find linguistic teachers who mimic or fake accents, or you find linguistic teachers who do not mimic or fake accents? I do not understand the question, but then yes, many linguists are monolingual. We don't see what could be a problem, but it could be also beneficial for linguists to know more languages than one. So I personally know many linguists who know many languages. I personally know many linguists who do not know many languages, but they do try to learn more languages. It's getting increasingly more common for linguists to do that. But it was, yes, for, I know there are many famous linguists who know only one language. So that, those examples, counter examples are also there. So, yes, so I think it is not, and so understanding linguistic theory is considered, you know, something which is not essential to know many. So as much as we try, we may not be able to learn very many languages. So there's always a limitation. So that we have to be always aware of that. So I think we have come to the end of this live session. And thank you very much for your questions. And if there are any more questions, then there is this ask the discussion forum. Those can be posted there. And I enjoyed having the live session with you very much. So thank you very much.